So last time we essentially discussed storage devices, mainly the disk and the tape. And the remainder part of the computer technology is made up of memory and the processor, things which go inside any box that you see. And today, in both the sessions, we'll discuss these components of the architecture, particularly about the system architecture, system buses, how these things are connected to each other. And we will also briefly describe how the software layers which sit on top of this hardware, how do they bind themselves to the hardware, as well as, on the other hand, with the applications that we write. The cache is the fastest and the most costly form of storage. It's volatile, and it is managed by the computer system hardware. This is even faster than the main memory, which is the fastest amongst all storage devices. Fast access, tens of nanoseconds to hundreds of nanoseconds, but generally too small in size and too expensive to store the entire database. So we go back to our premise that our information system data, which is required to be persistent, that means it should always be available without any effect of any failure of the power, etc., will never be stored in memory. It will be stored on disk. But for processing any information, you need to bring it out into the computer's box. And it is in this context that it might be useful to just look at a particular simple architectural diagram. We shall expand on this later. So if you look at the various components of technology, last time we discussed about magnetic disks and magnetic tapes. And these will store non-volatile data. That means data will remain here permanently. The computer itself internally has a processor, or central processing unit as we call it, and it has the main memory in which not only the data but even instructions are stored. Now, the processor does all the computational work, which means if it has to process something, the data must be fed into the processor. Just like memory has multiple locations, the processor also has certain temporary memory locations which are called registers. So it's like a register or a notebook that you will keep. Essentially, the computer processor gets data from the memory into these registers, performs addition, subtraction, comparison, whatever, multiplication, whatever operation, and then pushes the data back from the registers into the memory. The communication between memory and processor happens through a specific channel, which is often called the bus of the computer, or the memory system bus. So that means the data from memory must actually come out onto this bus. It must travel here, and it must get into the processor, and vice versa. This is a two-way communication. Imagine this bus to be some kind of a network between memory and computer. You will suddenly realize that all issues that we discussed in networking, namely the delays, the movement of the packets, the protocol required, etc., in some sense, all of that is required even for this communication. In fact, the protocols that we discussed in network under networking are actually called communication protocols. And since there is a communication between processor and memory, there has to be some protocol between. Apart from facilitating the movement of data, the protocols also actually act as an overhead, where the time that is required for that protocol to execute itself acts as an overhead for the time. As I said, the access time to memory typically is tens to hundreds of nanoseconds. You know nanosecond, right? So it's second, microsecond, nanosecond. Okay, so nanoseconds are extremely small. But what this means is that if from just outside the memory, you want to access contents of a memory location, it will take this much time. If from just outside the memory, you want to push some contents and write them in memory location, it will take this much of time. But what about the time that is required for moving the data from here all the way to processor and back? Now that is a non-trivial time. The registers, on the other hand, and the ability of the processor to carry out the calculations has been becoming faster and faster and faster. That, as we shall see later, is determined by the processor clock. The processor clock is one which keeps generating pulses at a regular frequency called the clock frequency. And actually, execution happens at those pulses. You send one pulse, some instruction will be executed. Another pulse, another instruction will be executed, something of that sort. And these pulses have been becoming faster and faster and faster. You would have heard of clock rates of 2 gigahertz. So what is 2 gigahertz? That means how many pulses per second you will get if the clock is, say, 1 gigahertz? Anybody can do a quick arithmetic? How much is giga? Sorry? 10 to the power 9. So if you have 10 to the power 9 cycles per second, that means the time required for one pulse will be 1 upon 10 to the power 9 seconds or 10 to the power minus 9 seconds. How much is that? This is 1 nanosecond. So any processor which is working even at 1 gigahertz clock can send a pulse every nanosecond. Not necessarily every instruction of the computer will be executed in 1 nanosecond. But today's computer processor architecture, as we shall see, actually permits instruction to be executed every cycle. Now, an instruction cannot execute in isolation. An instruction requires some data to act on. If the data is inside the registers, the processing of that data, addition, subtraction, comparison, etc., all can be done in one instruction. But to get that data from memory to processor or push that data back, if you are going to require tens or hundreds of nanoseconds, clearly, the processor is going to wait stupidly for the data to move around. In order to avoid this waiting time, what people do is when they design these processors, they put an extra memory here. And this memory is called the cache memory. The cache memory is as fast as the registers. That means it can respond in 1 nanosecond or less. And it is intrinsically tied to the processor. That means the protocol overhead for movement of information between cache and the processor are very minimal. Ideally then, we should put all our data, all our instructions in the cache itself so that the processor can quickly have access to it. But the cache memory is extremely costly. Because it is very fast, it is as costly as the intrinsic circuit registers of the processor itself, much costlier than the MEM. So consequently, the mechanism that is deployed in modern computer systems is that some of the memory data, based on some algorithms of usage, will be actually pushed into the cache. Whenever processor requires to access some data, it will first try to locate it in cache. If it finds it, it has finished the work. If it does not find it, it will go to the memory. Now, typically in a computer program, as you would say, for example, you have, let's say, an iteration, do I equal to 1 to 100 something something. And let's say you are calculating something for 100 array elements. It stands to reason then that while processing these instructions, you will first access one location here, then the second location, then the third location, then the fourth location. If these consecutive locations have been allocated to an array, which is normally the case, consequently, what is done intrinsically in these algorithms is, whenever a processor does not find something here, and it has to get it from the memory, it will not get only data from one location. In a burst, it will transfer data for something like 20, 30, 100 consecutive locations and stuff it in the cache. So that next time when the processor wants a data, the likelihood of that data being found in the cache itself increases. It is quite surprising that the achievements of these algorithms is phenomenal. They talk of a cache hit rate. That means percentage of the time that the processor wants to access some data and it is found in cash itself rather than to have to go here. This cash hit rate is often in excess of 95%. Of course, there is an asynchronous movement of data between the cache and memory, which is handled by cache controllers independent. So, memory and cache both have multi-access point devices. It is not, although it is shown to be connected here on one path, there are sort of multiple doors to this memory. So that while processor is accessing some part of the memory, the disk may be accessing some part of the memory, some other part of the memory for pushing the data out or reading the data in it. There is a lot of parallelism built in here. Similarly, there is a lot of parallelism between cache and memory, cache and the processor as well. So in a nutshell then, cache memory is almost as fast as the internal register memory of the processor. It is of course much more costlier, and therefore you don't have very large amount of cache memory. It is, for example, not uncommon these days to have something like 64 megabytes of cache or 128 megabytes of cache when the main memory is of the order of 2 gigabytes or 4 gigabytes. Okay. When main memory is of the order of 1 megabyte used to be there, the cache would be of the size of 64 kbytes. But people always try to put this kind of a buffer. So that's the purpose of the cache. Is that clear, the purpose of the cache then? Fine. When you decide on the configuration of a computer, some of the nitty-gritties that you would be expected to look at would be that if you have a processor, what is the speed of the processor? If you have memory, what is the size of the memory? And what is the access time of the memory? Just like your seek time and rotational delay for disk, there is an access time to the memory. Because 10 nanoseconds and 100 nanoseconds would make one memory 10 times slower than the other. And then what is the amount of cache and what is the kind of cache hit rate that you get? These are obviously important parameters from the perspective of movement of data. So coming back to our discussion, the cache is the fastest and most costly form of storage, and it is managed by the computer system hardware. The main memory is the next faster element. It has fast access, but generally it is not big enough to store the entire database. Let me also tell you that last 15 years, there have been efforts in a direction called main memory databases. In these cases, you put the entire database in main memory itself. Then we are not talking about 1 gigabyte of memory or 2 gigabytes of memory. We are talking about hundreds of gigabytes of memory where the entire database sits inside. Why would such a requirement be there? And what would happen if the memory collapses? So in such cases, you never let memory collapse. Such memory is always what is known as battery backed up. That means it is almost equivalent of a non-volatile storage, although it is random access memory. The capacities of main memory are up to a few gigabytes, and these are widely used currently of this capacity basically. The capacities have gone up and per byte costs have decreased steadily and rapidly. The semiconductor memory costs have been reducing drastically and they will continue to fall further. When they continue to fall further, there is always a desire to use larger and larger memory. But simultaneously, this technology also gets pushed further, and you are getting disks which are also cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. So any idea about what would rupees 1500 buy today in terms of hard disk? You'll get any hard disk for 1500 rupees or no? Yes, you will. So what's the capacity? 80 GB. So notice that if you can get 1 gigabyte of main memory for 1500 rupees, you get 80 gigabytes of stable storage or even slightly more for the same amount. Now that ratio unfortunately continues. Although that ratio has been diminishing, that ratio continues. So the time by which you will get 80 gigabytes of main memory, you will still get about 500 gigabytes of disk storage for the same price. And this distinction will continue. But what it means for us is that increasingly smaller applications which have, let's say, databases of the size of few gigabytes, which are traditionally always put on test, it may be possible if you have a battery backup, a UPS supported PC or something, it may be possible to have in-memory databases in a short while, where your processing capacity and performance will improve enormously. Why? Because you simply don't have to do disk accesses. Just to make a comparison, if memory access is of the order of tens or hundreds of nanoseconds, any location requires the same amount of access. Okay. And imagine that you are building B trees or B plus trees in memory. So that means in order to reach a particular pointer to data, you require, let's say, 4, 5, 6 accesses. And then to get the data, you require one more access to get that pointer. Of course, from the disk, you will read a large block. And if you want to read that large block, you will be required to spend so many nanosecond cycles of memory to get all that data. But all of this would be at least 1,000 times faster than any access to disk. So if we actually have that kind of performance, which is now likely, the hardware component availability will permit you to have it. So to recapitulate, per byte costs have decreased steadily and rapidly, but the contents remain volatile. Main memory contents are lost if a power failure occurs or a system crash occurs. You have to live with that. You are all familiar with the flash memory. All the USB pen drives that you carry, they are flash memory. The flash memory is something on which the data can be written at a location only once, but the location can be erased and returned to again. What is fundamentally different between a flash memory and normal memory? In normal memory, the number of times you can read or write to a location is practically infinite. Nothing happens to that memory location. Okay, so you keep writing, keep reading. Every time you remove the power, the contents will be lost. Again, you can write something, etc., etc. There is no difference in reading or writing operation. In a flash memory, however, while you can read any number of times, if you want to write to a location, then there are two possibilities. Either you are writing it for the first time, in which case it will take a normal memory write. But if you are writing it again, that means somebody else has written it already, then there is a process called erasing the contents. So you have what we call electronically erasable read-only memories, or EEPROMs or EEPROMs. And that action requires time. More importantly, how many times can you write and erase is not same as how many times you can read. So erasing of memory typically again has to be done on an entire bank of memory. These are some intrinsic characteristics because of the nature of the technology that is used. But once you have written something onto the disk, onto the flash memory, you can read it almost as fast as the main memory. Slightly slower. You don't have tens or hundreds of nanosecond speed, but reading is almost like 100 nanosecond plus kind of speed if you just want to read. Now you have suddenly a different dimension of technology. The flash memory is much cheaper than the main memory, but still much costlier than disk. The reason you should be very keenly following flash disk is because for your generation and generations next, the flash disk would become a genuine contender for storing non-volatile data for your databases. Yeah, sorry. Yes, you see, when I mentioned that there are now digital disks or solid state disks which are now available, those solid state disks now come with an interface where that interface itself is designed like a hot swappable interface for a conventional disk. As a matter of fact, the packaging of these solid state disks is exactly like any other ordinary disk. So that these two are indistinguishable except for the speed of operations. So in a normal storage which is designed to take hot swappable disks, it is possible to insert these disks. They even come with device drivers which are very similar to SCSI or anything else. They add to the overhead of performance, but since the intrinsic performance is so much faster, that those overheads don't mind. So integration of flash memory into regular solid state disk as a replacement or complement to regular disk has started happening in the last few years and will continue to happen. And that's why I said your generation of information engineers have the privilege of witnessing this transition. And then therefore you also have the privilege of deciding how to optimally and most cost effectively use these kind of flash disks along with the conventional disks. So is this clear? The problem is that it has a limited number of write cycles or erase cycles, and that's the reason why you're not comfortable. By the way, the number of such write erase cycles is increasing every year with technology. So reads are roughly as fast as main memory, but writes are slow. It may take a few microseconds. And erase is still slower. People are improving the write speeds, but erase continue to be much slower than either reads or writes. The cost per unit of storage is roughly similar to main memory. This is the biggest advantage, that roughly at the main memory price, you are able to get solid state storage which is non-volatile. So you don't require a battery backup. So even with these problems, you can live with those. Obviously, the biggest usage of flash memory is in embedded devices. You would have seen all digital cameras, you put a storage card so that your photographs remain there, or any speech recorders or music players, all of them have these kind of Yes, in fact, the flash memory is usually often used to carry software versions for embedded systems. So you have a processor and some memory which drives, let's say, a washing machine. And washing machine has certain functionality. Please note that almost all the functionality that you see in such gadgets is driven by software. Software decides the functionality. Of course, the software then drives the actuators, the sensors and everything, but it is essentially the software function. So if you want to replace a software, how do you do that? You can go into this washing machine and do something. So modern days it is fashionable to build embedded systems where they can actually take their functional programs from a socket in which such contents are inserted as USB flash drive. And this will become more and more and more common as we go ahead. So electrically erasable, programmable read-only memory, as I mentioned, the read-only memory is a misnomer. The moment it is erasable and programmable, you can write. The only point being made here is that writing is slow, erasing is still slow, but reading is as fast, and the cost is not very high. But do remember this, going forward, you would increasingly find flash disks replacing the conventional magnetic disk for many applications. As he pointed out, in embedded systems, it is already happening. You don't require a conventional magnetic disk anymore. These disks are good enough. And almost all digital cameras, everything in the world usually have these. Some of you might have seen long time ago, for example, a handycam which came with a CD or a DVD. So you would actually write that directly onto a CD or DVD. You don't do that anymore. You write directly to a solid state storage. And then that solid state storage can be later on used to transfer information from any one place to another. Next, we discuss the central processing unit, which traditionally is said to comprise of one control unit and the other ALU, or arithmetic and logic unit. The control unit traditionally controls the sequence of signaling and the sequence of movement of information across the circuits of computation. And the actual computational circuits were called arithmetic and logic unit. So ALU or arithmetic and logic unit is the one which is responsible for actual execution of instruction. Many of you would know the basic mechanism of instruction execution, but those of you who do not have the background in electronics and computer processors, I would like to very, very briefly mention at least a very simplistic representation of how instructions are executed inside the computer, so you get an idea of what happens inside. What I am depicting here is, let's say, the main memory of the computer, which contains these instructions. Let me first tell you that the way digital computers work is that the memory of the computer is used not only to store the data, but it is also used to store the instructions of the program. Here we are not talking about a Fortran program or a C program or a SQL program, but we are talking about a program which results when you compile the higher-level language programs, link those with all the libraries, and create what is known as an executable binary. An executable binary contains pure play binary instructions which the computer can execute. All these instructions in a program ordinarily reside in the disk as a part of that program. But whenever you load that program, whenever you tell the operating system, please execute this program, the entire program, meaning all its instructions, come and sit inside the computer's main memory. And what I am depicting here are two of these instructions. A typical instruction, which is in a binary format, has two components. One component, which is called the operational code or opcode. For example, 01011010 may mean an operational code implying addition of some numbers to be done. 10110001 may mean subtraction to be done. Some other code may mean put this data into this location. Some other code may mean take this data from that location and bring it to processor. Another code will mean compare these two numbers. Anytime an instruction has to be executed, the purpose of that instruction will require that some more data be fetched from memory and handled. And that some other data is pointed to by the remaining part, which is known as the address part. I have shown here an 8-bit operational code, and any number of bits that will fit a memory location as the address part. But suppose I can store only one address. Now, when I say operation code is add two numbers, then I need to specify three locations, right? Two numbers to be added, and the result is to be kept somewhere. Both these numbers to be added are somewhere in the memory, and the final result also has to be kept somewhere in the memory. How will I specify three locations? So people do a trick. When they design the circuit, they decide that addition of a particular address, when a single address is mentioned, is that you have a register inside the main memory. We assume that register contains something already, one of the numbers. If the address is prescribed, I will add the contents of that address to this register. And I will put the result in register itself. So suppose I want to add 7 and 5 to get result 12. And let's say I have this number 7 in one location, 5 in one location. I will, by executing one instruction, try to get this 7 into the register. So this is my register. I will get 7 here. The register contains this. Now I will execute an add instruction, which will point to an address which points to 5. What that instruction will mean is, take the contents of this register, take the contents of the address which is shown here, which is number 5, add 7 and 5, and put the result in this register itself. So that means when you require to specify three addresses, two for the operands and one for the result, you can get away by specifying only one address and by letting register be the default address for the other two things. One of the operands is in register and the result will also be in the register. I hope you can appreciate this simple trick. Of course, this means that if you really want to add two registers, initially you have to fetch one of the numbers from the memory and put it in register, for which there will have to be one instruction. Then you perform addition. And finally, the result from the register, you will be required to take it back and put it in some actual memory location. So you have to execute three instructions to carry out one addition. But since instructions are happening fast, that is okay. So this is the way instructions work inside the machine. However, how exactly does one instruction execute? And let's say this is that instruction. Consider this is an add instruction. So there is an address where it has to add the existing value, which let's say is 7, the address points to 5. First of all, as long as the instruction is in main memory, it cannot be executed. Who executes instructions? The processor. The processor has two parts. What are the two parts we just mentioned? It is the arithmetic and logic unit which is responsible for carrying out addition, subtraction, as the name suggests. But this whole thing cannot do any operation unless the instruction is brought from the memory to the computer's processor. This particular operation of getting instruction from the main memory of the computer inside the computer's processor is called a fetch operation. So in the fetch operation, when the fetch operation is executed, computer goes to this memory location, fetches this entire content and brings it into the controller. Once the instruction has been fetched inside the CPU, the computer will then carry out a decode operation. Remember, this instruction is now here. What does decode mean? Decode means that the processor will look at the operational code part of that instruction. It says 10110101 and it will suddenly recognize, this means addition. Some other bit pattern may mean subtraction. Some other bit pattern may mean load memory from this content to register. Some other bit pattern may mean store the register content to memory, whatever one. So there is a decode operation. After the decode operation, the computer understands that it has to perform an add activity. That additional activity will be performed by this arithmetic and logic unit. It will be performed with respect to register, assumed to contain one value, and it will be performed with respect to another address which has been found during decode phase, from which the other operand has to be fetched. All these operations will then be done by ALU. That part is called the execute phase. There are two questions that we need to answer. One, how does a computer know that it has to fetch instruction from this location and not from some other location? And the beauty of the architecture of the basic digital computer, which is still known as von Neumann architecture. Have you heard of this gentleman? I think I mentioned his name once. He is the creator of the concept of a stored program digital computer. He was a great mathematician come engineer of the last century. He is also credited with the complete new field of knowledge called operations research. He wrote a treaty along with Morgenson on theory of games and operations research or something. It's a well-known treaty. But he was also creator of this particular logic. So what he said is, remember I mentioned executable program? Let's say it has 1,000 instructions. An executable program typically continues to execute all its instructions one after another. So what the operating system does is it puts all the 1,000 instructions in the memory and the starting point, whatever is the address, that address is passed on to the processor, saying, okay, you have to start from here. That particular address is called program counter. That means I am executing an instruction at this point. So the computer automatically fetches from that program counter contents, decodes it, executes it. Once that instruction is executed, unless something else happens, it will go to the next location. So it will simply increment the program counter by one, fetch the next instruction from next location, and so on, automatically. So you don't have to worry about where to go to fetch an instruction. Of course, you might have jump instruction, if instruction, etc. In which case, when you execute an instruction of the type jump, that instruction will not do any arithmetic operation, but it will simply change the program counter. It will say, next instruction, don't get from this location, but go somewhere else and get that. So this is how you decide where to get the instructions from. Second, when you execute these instructions, now that we know that each instruction requires a fetch, a decode, and execute, how long should it take the computer to completely execute one instruction? Clearly, there are three phases. We already agreed that any activity inside the computer will happen whenever a particular clock pulse is generated. So at least one clock pulse is required to fetch an instruction, another will be required to decode, another will be required to begin execution. Whether the execution happens within a single clock cycle or the ALU itself has circuitry which requires 4, 5, 10, 20 clocks to complete that will depend upon the circuitry. But minimum three clock cycles appear to require to execute one instruction. Now this will make the whole operation very slow. So what people say, the designers said, is that can I make this faster? And they created the notion of a pipeline. What does a pipeline mean? Suppose this instruction is being fetched by this computer. It has been fetched and now the processor is busy decoding this instruction. When the previous instruction is being decoded, memory is free. So the processor says, why not, while the previous instruction is being decoded, why not I go and fetch the next instruction? So I can do that parallelly. While the previous instruction is being decoded, I can fetch the next instruction. Now imagine the previous instruction is now being executed. The decoder unit is free. So why not the decoder unit now decodes the next instruction that has been fetched? And the fetching unit now goes and fetches the third instruction. So consequently, you have a pipeline . There is one instruction which has been fetched, let's say, long time ago. After that instruction has been fetched, you have a decode, or it's the other way around. Fetch here, decode here, and execute here. So when one instruction is being fetched, the previous is being decoded and previous to previous is being executed. Once this instruction is executed, it goes out of the pipeline. This one then is executed. This one is then fetched, is decoded, and another one is fetched. Consequently, assume for the simplicity that each of these activities requires one clock cycle. Then while for executing one instruction end to end, we still require three clock cycles. But at the end of this pipeline, you will start one instruction, you will start seeing one instruction getting executed every cycle. So in one cycle, this instruction is executed. In the next cycle, the one which was decoded will get executed. Consequently, you will have one cycle per instruction kind of behavior. So if your clock rate is 2 gigahertz, you can actually execute 2 giga instructions per second of this type, as opposed to 2 by 3 only. Obviously, the execute time for the decoded instructions may take large number of cycles independently, and that continues to be the major distinction between two types of ALU architectures or the computer architectures. One is called the complex instruction set architecture. The other is called the reduced instruction set architecture or the RISC computers. Reduced instruction set computer is called the RISC machine, and as opposed to RISC, the standard thing is called the CISC machine. The CISC machine, typically an execution of an instruction will require variable number of cycles depending upon the complexity of instruction. Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division will take much longer. Load and store data from memory will take lesser time. Compare and take some action will take different kind of time. So these are the different things that happen in CISC. The RISC machines, because of their design, they are reduced number of instructions. So consequently, a conventional higher level language program may compile into many more RISC instructions than CISC instructions. But the guarantee is that RISC machines will execute one instruction per cycle. And now the latest, if this pipeline gives you one cycle per instruction kind of execution time, today's computers, a single chip, this is your processor chip, These processor chips today no more contain a single ALU and control unit. That is a single processor. They contain what is known as multiple cores. So a core is a combination of ALU and processor and is able to independently execute instruction. Consequently, today, if you have a four-core processor, what it means is you got actually a four-processor machine. But these four processors are not separate as in four different processor chips or boards, but they are all integrated inside a single chip. And now imagine the complexity of the architecture to support these kind of things. Obviously, if a core is an independent processor ALU kind of thing, you must provide for its own cache. You must provide for an independent path from that to memory. You must provide for isolation of instruction execution of that core while other instructions are being executed by another core and so on. In short, whatever you would do with multiple processors existing inside a normal computer architecture, which we shall see in a moment, you will now be required to do the same thing inside a chip when you have multiple cores like this. The purpose of sharing all of this is to indicate that the processor technology is also rapidly making strides and giving you performance possibilities which were hitherto were not available. So to go back to our slide then, is this clear that the central processing unit has a control unit and arithmetic and logic unit, and that the way instructions are executed is that every instruction needs to be fetched, it needs to be decoded, and then it needs to be executed. And after this is done, the computer goes to execute the next instruction in sequence. And because it automatically fetches instructions in sequence, you have this behavior of a stored program computer where instructions are executed in sequence one after another. Okay. And you understand now the notion of a pipeline that gets intrinsically created inside through the additional circuitry. This is again a recap of something that I already mentioned. Processor has registers, which are something like fast memory locations. They are internal to the processor. The data is read from memory, has to be processed and written back. The processing has to happen inside the computer using these registers as temporary storage. A clock synchronizes actions. Typical clocks could be 300 megahertz, 500 megahertz, 1 gigahertz. This has improved from 1 kilohertz upwards. So you can imagine the speed, enormous speed increase which has happened in the computers. 1 kilohertz means what? 1,000 cycles per second. Okay. So one clock would be how much? 1 microsecond. That is the fastest speed. In those days, the memories used to be milliseconds. So it was okay. And nothing happened in 1 microsecond. All machines were CISC or complex instruction set computers. Typical execution time of any arithmetic instruction would be anywhere between 10 cycles to 200 cycles. And if you had a floating point arithmetic to be done, you had it. It was so complex. Okay. However, things have changed drastically now. But this has been the speed improvement. Another recap, we mentioned RISC and CISC processors. RISC stands for Reduced Instruction Set Computers, and CISC stands therefore for Complex Instruction Set Computers. Normal computers, which are complex instruction set computers, were never called like this unless the design of Reduced Instruction Set Computer emerged, after which all other old style computers were getting called as complex instruction set computers. In terms of the popular architecture, what is known as x86 architecture, you are familiar with Intel processors. So Intel 286, 386, 486, Intel Pentium, okay, whatever. All the Intel processors up to Intel 80486 were strictly CISC processors. Intel Pentium and beyond have huge RISC kind of architecture. But because they need to maintain backward compatibility, these processors are both CISC and RISC. So they can execute CISC instructions, but they are essentially a RISC process. We already discussed the notion of pipelining. The pipelining really becomes very heavy now. For example, instead of having a single fetch unit, can I have multiple fetch units? Can I have multiple decode units? Can I have multiple execution units? And having multiple core inside the same processor means, can I have multiple combinations of these? Which is exactly what you see now that is happening. But pipelining is a beautiful engineering concept which actually gives you a larger throughput, although individual instruction may still require multiple cycles or multiple pulses. Okay. Number of instructions that you can execute per second has been always a crude measure of the performance capability of a processor. The early processors could execute a few thousand instructions per second. Then it went to hundreds of thousands of instructions per second. The first processor, which could execute 1 million instructions per second, was called a 1 MIPS processor. It was a processor from a company called Digital Equipment Corporation. The DEC machine on WAX 1100, 730 or 750 for the first time deployed a processor which could execute 1 million instructions per second. In today's terminology, if one instruction is executed per cycle, 1 million instructions per second would mean what is the clock rate? 1 megahertz. Compare 1 megahertz with 1 gigahertz. At a very crude level, how much faster a processor with 1 gigahertz clock is? 1 gigahertz is 1000 megahertz. So 1000 times faster. So you have 1000 MIPS processors today. Not very long time ago, 11750, 11780 are the machines that I am talking about. These are machines of early 80s, mid 80s, and they continue up to mid 80s. That means just 20, 25 years ago, you had machines which were 1,000 times slower, and they were considered the then fastest processors. Ordinary processors were still slow. That's just to recapitulate the history of movement. But MIPS was therefore an important parameter of measuring performance. MIPS was not related to RISC type of process where every instruction takes the same time to execute, namely one cycle. Those days, different instructions took different number of cycles. And if a computer had to execute 1 million instructions per second, you have to define what is the combination of instructions you are considering. Consequently, people created an equivalent of a measurable load, saying so many add instructions, so many multiply instructions, so many divide instructions, so many jump instructions, so many load, so many store. There's a variety of things. We'll take this conglomerate together and find out how long it takes to execute this. And divide that by the total number of instructions that were executed to find out the MIPS rating of the process. So MIPS was not a single type of simple instruction being executed again and again. It was a well-defined suit of instructions, combination of instructions representing a typical computational workflow. It of course handled only integer operations for comparison. It was very obvious that for computational purposes, floating point operations will cost much more. You agree with that? Okay. Adding or subtracting two simple numbers versus adding or subtracting two floating point numbers or multiplying two floating point numbers is much more complicated than adding or subtracting integer. Consequently, there was another measure which was called FLOP or floating point operations per second. And you again tended to measure millions of floating point operations per second. So consequently, computers which actually did heavy computing in the early days to justify this word, they measured their performance in megaflops. Even today, you measure the performance of supercomputers in terms of flops, because floating point operations is the key, is considered the most complex instruction. And how many floating point operations can you execute per second is an important. So the parallel computers that are there today, they don't perform at 1 megaflop or 2 megaflop or 10 megaflop. They don't even perform at 1 gigaflop. They try to perform at teraflops. And teraflops you just don't have a single processor which can execute instructions at that speed. So very obviously you require a different strategy. As we shall shortly see in the next session, the idea of putting multiple processors together to harness their computational power to get much more computational speed than otherwise possible with a single processor has what resulted in different kinds of computer architectures. We shall see that in a short while, but first let's complete the discussion on the basic measure of performance for a processor. So it is MIPS and megaflops. Is that clear? These were the early measures. The more common measures today applied to measure the basic computational capability of a processor is in terms of spec int and spec float. Spec is another specification, much like a combination of certain number of instructions put together and measuring the execution time of those instructions and finding out an average. Except that MIPS and flops represent a combination which belong to the old style. Spec has come out to be the new specification of the combination of instructions which are considered a measurement kernel or measurement benchmark. This benchmark exists for both integer and floating point operations. And consequently, you have spec int and spec float. So instead of MIPS and megaflops, which nobody really talks about today, you talk of spec int and spec float. These are the two parameters which are invariably published by the manufacturers of processors. So as far as individual processors' raw capability of computation is concerned, it is always measured in terms of spec int and spec float. As we shall later on see, this capability need not necessarily translate into a corresponding capability of doing information system transaction fast. For that, there is a set of other sort of parameters and characterization that is required. We shall comment on that performance measure separately. But as far as the raw processing capability of a processor is concerned, you measure it in terms of spec int and spec float. Is that clear? The native language is a notion which says, given a processor, it can execute instructions which are written in its native language. Two processors may have different native language if for the same instruction, they have a different coding scheme, as simple as that. If for one computer, 101011 means addition, but 101011 means subtraction for something else, that fellow's language is different. Okay. No matter what the native instruction set or instruction native language of a processor is, we are buffered from all that, because whenever we say we have a compiler, that compiler will translate a higher level language, which is common, into the particular native language code for that process. That's the reason why you cannot survive without compilers when you buy any new machine. You must have compilers which will translate instructions into the native language of that particular process. In terms of memory, there are multiple chips. This is slightly old dated information, 256 KB, 1 MB, 4 MB, 8 MB, 16 MB, okay. 32 MB. So these are chips. And these individual chips have, when I say KB, notice that this is small b, kilobits, megabits. So you have only bits. If you want to make a word of 8 bits, where you want to store a byte, you typically put 8 such chips together. You say chip 1 represents the 0th bit, chip 2 represents first bit, second bit, 8th bit, or 9, 10, 32 bits, whichever way you want. Clearly, each chip can be handled independently in terms of accessing a bit or writing a bit at a location. So you again have something like a cylinder on the disk. You have in these 8 chips, you have location 1, which goes across the location 2, location 3, whatever, whatever. Larger the capacity of a chip in bits, the larger will be the total byte capacity when you put all of them together. It is customary not to put 8 bits to organize even a byte word. You normally have additional chips which will correspond to parity bit. You can have one parity bit, two parity bit. So error correcting codes, error detecting codes, all of these will be deployed on the memory. The word length and address length are two important concepts. Word length is the capacity of a unit, and address length means how many such units you can put. So for example, word length of 8 bit means each memory location is 1 byte long. Word length of 64 bit means each memory location is 64 bits or 8 bytes long. But how many such locations you can have depends upon how many addresses you can put. The situation is very comparable to a hypothetical residential colony of houses, where each house has a certain capacity in terms of rooms. You can say that that is the word length. How many bedrooms or how many rooms are there in a house? How many houses can you have in the colony? That depends upon the addressing scheme. Suppose you have decided that you should be able to uniquely address each house by a 3-digit number. Then the smallest number you can assign a house is 000. Largest number you can assign a house is 999. You can uniquely identify 1,000 houses, no matter what is the capacity of an individual house. So an individual house has 4 rooms or 1 room or 8 rooms, it doesn't matter. In computer terminology, all houses have same number of rooms, same number of bits or bytes. And that is the capacity of a house or the word length. And in computer terminology, address is how many bits do you specify to uniquely address a particular memory location. So if you have a 64-bit addressing scheme, then how many addresses can you specify? 2 to the power 64. So you can have 2 to the power 64 different locations, distinct locations. Whether each location is 1 byte or 2 bytes or 4 bytes or 8 bytes depends upon the capacity of that. Ordinarily, almost all computers have memory basically organized as byte memory. That means each location is 1 byte. And how many locations you can have depends upon the addressing scheme that you have. I already mentioned single point versus multi-point access. What it means is that you make a memory structure such that you can access it only through one door. So while one fellow is accessing the memory, nobody else can access it. Multi-point access is a very common thing in memory, where you say that since memory is now the main thing from which instructions will have to go to a processor, data may have to go to disk or come from disk, it may have to go to a printer unit. There may be multiple processors which may all require my memory. So consequently, memory now has 4 doors, 8 doors, 24 doors, multiple access points. So different fellows from the bus can access it, access different portions of the memory. Naturally, nobody wants multiple people to access the same location of the memory. Well, there are 16-bit addresses, 32-bit addresses, the address. Oh, this is not, I mean, what he is pointing out is a fallacy that we talk of huge, large gigabytes capacity, but if the addressing scheme is smaller, how do we handle that? We had a very peculiar situation when a particular computer company, those days in India, we used to design computers and design and write operating systems and design and write compilers because import was not possible. In those days, the early computers which came were 8-bit processors. That means their addressing scheme was 8 bits. How much maximum memory you can have in 8 bits? 2 raised to power 8. That is 64,000. So if you have bytes, you have 64,000 bytes. The 8-bit microprocessor-based CPM machines typically had 64 kilobytes of memory because that's the maximum memory that was possible. Then came the processors which have 16-bit addressing scheme. 16-bit suddenly means you could address how much memory? 2 to the power 16, which is? Yes? 1 megabytes. And they said, okay, here you have 1 megabyte of memory. One such computer was purchased by our metallurgical engineering department, which claimed that you can have 1 megabyte of memory. The metallurgical engineering department, that research group, was working on a whole lot of computational thing where they required larger arrays. So a professor there took his Fortran program. In the earlier Fortran program, he had defined smaller arrays because they could not be accommodated. This time he declared bigger arrays and started running that program, and the compiler said, cannot allocate memory. And he said, what is this nonsense? The computer has more memory. The computer had larger memory, but what they are given is, they are given the old compiler. The old compiler knew that maximum memory is 64 KB, so it would not allocate more than 64 kilobytes to any single array. So you can see how the limitations could go on, even if the basic limitation is exceeded. Because there is end-to-end system that you need. You must make sure that every component handles a larger capacity if it becomes available at the lower level. So that's a fact of life. That happens. Okay. You take the same thing for disk. How much should be a disk pointer length? Imagine a pointer length is 32 bits. A pointer, which is an address on the disk block. So if you can have 32-bit pointers, how many disk blocks can you address by 32-bit pointers? 2 to the power 32, which is how much? 4 gigablocks. Okay. What if you have a disk capacity which is much more than this? How will you access? Suppose you are interested in accessing an individual block which is one of the identifiable blocks in a disk conglomerate of 1000 disks. You want to treat all these 1000 disks as a single volume and identify each block individually. You can't. Is this limitation based on the processor? No. Because how much should be the length of your pointer is a decision taken by someone who is writing software. The processor, etc., has nothing to do with what should be the length of pointer on accessing a block. That's all hypothetical. A disk is a disk. You can decide in as many blocks as you want. You can make blocks of very small size, or you can make blocks of larger size, smaller blocks. So these aberrations, as you point out, have happened in the entire industry for all the years. And the effort is to keep changing or keep modifying these aberrations. To avoid that, you know, to avoid the problem of address space, there's one particular computer called IBM AS400. Some of you might have heard of this. AS400 was originally, the whole architecture was designed by Dr. Soltis. And I remember when I met him many years ago in Rochester, Milwaukee, a very cold place where AS400 design happens. He says, people talk of abstraction and object orientation. He says, we did all that in AS400 long time ago. You know, AS400 has some processor and its memory and access, word length and address space, etc., etc. But the entire AS400 software was conceived and written assuming 128-bit pointer size. So address space, logically, was always 128-bit. No matter whether the underlying processor is 8-bit, 14-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, or 256. And this abstraction was superimposed on whatever hardware constituted AS400. I would say that was a very visionary decision taken there. Not all decisions are taken like that, particularly for commodity computers. So yes, the address space does matter. And it is prudent to now talk about address space both for memory, hot disk, in general, the address space of 64-bit or minimum 32-bit. Anything less than 32, in fact, 32-bit is fast going out of, let's say, popular usage, because that is considered clearly inadequate for the growing memory inside the computer's processor.
Does that mean with the increase in disk space, the access time will also increase?
Access time will not increase. Because the access time will still be determined by the disk rotation speed and the access speed.
Oh,
it doesn't matter, because once you move the arm, the physical movement of arm and physical movement of disk still determines that. So that will not happen.
When you talk about any memory, you always talk about like KB and MB, and you always go in multiples of 2. So if you have 1 GB as standard, you go multiples of 2, you should have 64 GB access. Why it is 80 GB and why, where is that number come from?
Actually,
it is 72 GB only.
Yes, it's an interesting question. What he is asking is that when we talk of memory, we generally talk in terms of multiples of 2. Why don't we do that when we talk in terms of disks? So that's a very interesting question. let us analyze it from the perspective of how these devices evolved. The memory address space, which is actually the defining parameter for the amount of memory that you will have, has always been measured in terms of bits. So address space is 16-bit, 32-bit, whatever, whatever. Since we follow the binary system in addressing, all binary numbers are integer multiples of 2 only, 2 raised to power something. And that is how the memory capacity is always defined in terms of 2 to the power something. On the other hand, if you take the disk is a rotational magnetic media. Depending upon how many platters you have, how many tracks you have on each platter, and what is the capacity of an individual track or sector, the total capacity will be determined. It was not uncommon for a long time for the disk tracks to have 6 platters and 10 surfaces. 6 platters should have 12 surfaces. So what they used to do is, because of the packaging, the top surface could not have an arm and the bottom surface of the last disk could not have an arm. So you had 10 surfaces on which you had these disks. Okay.